Thank God for having patience with me. I feel like I'm an Israelite, went through the desert for 4 years after I was saved, and finally I'm back.
Praise the Lord. So three simple questions for you, Vio. Do you love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and all your strength?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe in the Adventist mission to take the everlasting gospel to the whole world?
I do.
And do you believe that the core of that mission is that God desires not only to save us, but to restore us and make him like himself?
Amen.
I want to stand over here.
Theo, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Ghost. Amen. They changed the order on me. That's all right. Jed, I heard that you wanted to say something before.
I'd just like to thank my mom and dad for raising me and teaching me about Jesus. I'd also like to thank my Sabbath school teachers for giving me a more in-depth study on the Bible and about God. I'd like to especially thank Auntie Judy for going out of her way to give me Bible studies at home, which have prepared me for this day.
Amen. So, Jed, do you love Jesus with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength?
Yes.
And do you believe in the unique mission of the Adventist Church to take the gospel to all the world?
Yes.
And do you believe that part of that mission, or the core of that mission, I should say, is that Jesus not only wants to save us, but to restore us?
Yeah.
Amen.
Jed, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
This for what, almost a year now?
For 10 months.
10 months, almost 11. And she's been eager almost since the beginning for this day. Is there anything you want to say?
Yes, I do. I want to say thank you to my mom for being here. She was the best thing that ever happened in my life. So is my brother. He's been really amazing to me, and some of my other friends might be here, but I'm most lucky to be here.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, Liz, do you love Jesus with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength?
God is my helper.
And do you believe in the mission to take the everlasting gospel to everyone, everywhere?
Yes.
And do you believe that Jesus wants not only to save us, but to restore us?
Yes.
Amen.
Liz, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Sweet Jesus, my Savior, you are my faithful friend. You made me, you know me, and you see my every sin. And my soul is amazed by this gift of your grace and these arms that take me in. Sweet Jesus, my Savior, You are my faithful friend. Sweet Jesus, my shelter, you are my faithful friend, the refuge that I run to when the world comes closing in. Why should I be afraid when I know I am saved by the arms that take me in? Sweet Jesus, my shelter, you are my faithful friend. Oh yeah. Sweet Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
my shepherd,
my shepherd,
you are my faithful friend. You hold me, you lead me, I'll follow till the end. And once more I will say, on that beautiful day when your arms take me in, sweet Jesus, my shepherd, you are my faithful friend. Sweet Jesus, my Savior, you are my faithful friend.
A list of families in our church that we're upholding this week in our that'll be followed by Exodus 4:31 and 32:8.
Reading from Exodus 32:8. Ask, and the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for your people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Exodus 4:31. So the people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel, and that he had looked on their affliction, then they bowed their heads and they worshiped.
Reading from Revelation 14, 6, 7. The proclamations of three angels. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water. May you be blessed by these words.
I'll just ask Nika and Angel to come up for special music.
my journey like Israel of old. I travel through the wilderness so far away from home. The dangers of me strengthen my soul, and I will be strong. I will walk unafraid. With the Lord as my companion, every step along the way. Then come with me, I live with courage in my
with the Lord as my
All right, if we could have Vio, Jed, and Liz come forward, as well as our elders and deaconesses. There joy in heaven today?
Amen.
How do we know?
Because
the Bible says so, right? There is joy in heaven. Is there anyone who'd like to make a motion that we accept these three individuals into the grand family of the Grand Prairie Seventh-day Adventist Church? We have several. I think that counts as a second. All in favor? Any opposed? So carried. I wonder if Jesus is going to do that with the angels when we get home. They're going to vote us into heaven. We'll see. Do you want to come forward? Today is we're going to pray for you, because the Bible says there's two baptisms, the baptism of water and the baptism of God's Spirit. So we're going to pray for God's Spirit to fill you. All right. Heavenly Father, we stand before you, Lord, all sinners saved by grace, rejoicing in the fact that you love us, that you sent your Son to save us, and that Liz, Jed, and Bea want to express today, Lord, that they want to be yours. And so, Father, continue to lead them, to guide them, to fill them with your Spirit, and to make them more like you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Test, test. There we go. All right, are you ready? We're going to have to go fast. So brace yourselves. Worship. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. I'm going to turn that down just a hair. There we go. Worship is essentially a reaction to the realization of God. Could happen for all kinds of reasons, but it's where we're like, whoa, God is real, God is amazing, God is among us. So we looked at a story where Jehoshaphat and the people were about to be attacked, and they came together, and they prayed, and God answered. And when God answered, it says they bowed their heads and they worshiped. They say there's no atheists in foxholes. And I believe every person goes through experiences in their life where they worship. The question isn't whether or not we're going to worship at some point. The question is whether or not we're going to continue to worship. So I want you to open your Bibles this morning to Exodus chapter 4. I think for most of you, I hope all of you, this story is relatively familiar. Moses was tending sheep a long way from Egypt. His Egyptian life was behind him, thought he would never ever return. And in the midst of shepherding these sheep, he sees a bush that's burning but not burning. And he goes over to check it out, and a voice says, "Moses, take off your shoes, for the ground on which you're standing is holy." Of course, we hear things like that, and we get all crazy, and we make shrines, and we fence the area off and say, that's holy ground. But Moses had been to that place many times with his shoes on. The only reason it was holy that day was because God was there. And God is always on the move. Don't make holy places. Serve a holy God. God instructs Moses to go back to Egypt and to lead his people out of Egypt and out of slavery. Meanwhile, back in Egypt, Moses is long gone, probably mostly forgotten. But the people know one thing, they're still in slavery. And they know something else. Abraham promised that God would lead them out of slavery. Isaac kept the promise alive. Jacob kept the promise alive. Joseph kept the promise alive. And they're still living in the expectation that this is not going to last forever. They are going to be free. Are you living in expectation? Are you? Are you conscious every day that this is not all there is? Are you living in the very real promise that Jesus will return? Moses comes back and he announces to the people, "Hey, I'm here. God's here. Check this out. Check this out." And Exodus 4:31 says, when the people realize that God is on the verge of keeping his promise, they bow down and they worship. Now flip over to Exodus 32. Everybody there? Exodus 32? In Exodus 32, the same Moses who went to the burning bush, the same Moses who came back and told them that God was ready to deliver them, the same Moses who led them out of Israel, the same Moses who led them across the Red Sea, that same Moses is up on the mountain. Been up there for a while. And the people got impatient, you know the story, and they went to Aaron and they demanded that Aaron make them a god. And Aaron does. We'll pick it up in verse 4. He received the gold from their hand. He fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. And then they said, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord." They arose early on the next day, they offered burnt offerings, and they brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. The Lord said to Moses, "Go, get down, for your people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf. They have
They've worshiped it. And they've sacrificed to it. Same people. Less than a year later, these are the very same people. That should give us pause. I bet if I sat down with each one of you and had a conversation, one-on-one, and asked you, can you remember a point in your life which God really showed up? I bet every one of you could tell me a story. And I bet if you remember back to that moment, you worshiped. You knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that the God that your parents maybe told you about, or maybe your grandparents told you about, or maybe a preacher came along and told you, someone told you about. You knew for sure in that moment that he was living and he was real and he knew your name and he knew where you were and he was taking care of you. And you worshiped. But the fact that you live through a moment like that does not mean that you're worshiping him today. Three people today have publicly testified, today I want to give my life to Jesus. They worshiped. Worship always involves action. But you know what the devil's going to start doing probably before the sun goes down today? He's going to start doing something in every one of their lives to make them start on a path that he would have them end up worshiping something else. Maybe you're already there. Because the people in Exodus 32, they carry God's name and they're following God, but they're worshiping something else. If you analyze their story, it happened for all kinds of reasons. Chief of which was unmet expectations. You see, when they left Egypt to head for the promised land, God took them the wrong way. There was a highway that went right from Egypt to Canaan. Why didn't they take the highway? Well, the Bible tells us why they didn't take the highway, but the people didn't get it. The Bible says God knew that if they took the highway, they would encounter enemies on that highway, enemies who would scare them so bad that they would put their tail between their legs and run back to Egypt and go back into slavery to avoid the fear. And knowing that's what would happen, he led them through the wilderness where they wouldn't face that opposition, where he could gently take them through things that would build their strength, build their faith, build their confidence in God. But all they thought was, God took me the wrong way. When they got to Sinai, they had expectations. God's going to tell us exactly what he wants so we can get the promised land, and when we get the list, we'll fulfill it and we'll get in. They also had expectations that it wouldn't take that long. Moses will climb off the mountain, it'll take him about a day. He'll get the instructions from God, a couple days, he'll be back. Three at the most. A week went by. 2 weeks. 3 weeks. Expectations, they got restless. Maybe this is all a big joke. Maybe Moses isn't the person that we thought he was. Maybe the God who he says he's listening to, maybe Moses just has some problems. Maybe it's time to take our lives into our own hands and get us there ourselves. But you see, God never said Moses would be gone 3 days. That was an expectation that they created on their own. And the truth is, we all have those expectations. Spoken or unspoken. I got married and I expected it would go well. I love God. He loves God. She loves God. How could this ever fail? We had children. We expected that it would go well. Happy the home where Jesus lives. Expectations. When I married him or her, sure they weren't married, sure they weren't in the church yet, sure they weren't baptized, but that would come. They'll find Jesus and love him just like I do. Expectations. We all have them. And when Jesus doesn't meet them, when Jesus doesn't follow the plan, we start looking for answers in other places. Aaron, Moses is over. That's the period of our history. It's done. We got to face it. We got to move on. Let's build another God and go a different way. I heard another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting good news to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every kindred, every nation, every tongue, and every people, saying with a loud voice, a megaphone, trust God. Trust Him. Trust Him. Give Him glory. Praise Him in the storm. Praise Him when your expectations aren't met, knowing that whatever He's doing, it's better. It's better. Worship Him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that's in them. Do you remember Job? Talk about a guy with unmet expectations. I got married. I expected it would go well, that my wife would love me and love God and support me. I had children. I expected them to grow up, to prosper, and to do well. Well, one day he lost all his children. And not long after, his wife told him, curse God and die. And one by one, his friends came to visit and said, Job, I don't know what you've done, but you better straighten out, because God's not happy with you. And finally, Job, knowing that he hadn't purposely done anything wrong against God, broke down and said, God, what are you doing to me? What's happening? And after he let Job rant, God finally said, Job, where were you? Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Where were you when I drew a line in the sand and said the ocean can go this far and no further? Where were you? Yesterday, I said, Nathaniel, I need you to get dressed. I need your help. He said, what are we doing? I said, you get dressed. You'll find out what we're doing later. Nope. You tell me what we're doing, and then I'll get dressed. Why did he say that? Don't laugh at him, because we're all the same. Because we want to know what's going to happen all the time. We want to be in the know and basically in control. God doesn't parent us like that. He says, you follow me. I'll tell you where we're going to end up. I'll tell you that right now. But what's going to happen between here and there? Just follow me. Just follow me. Just come. Abraham, you've been trying to have children with Sarah. It's not working. Come. I'll give you what you can't do. You just come. Many things happened after that Abraham never foresaw. Some of them threw him for a loop. But he kept on going. And it says God counted his faith as righteousness. You've been told many things as a Seventh-day Adventist, from cheese to vegetarianism to who knows what. Mostly underneath all of that stuff is this idea that God will bring us home when we get it straight. God is not waiting for you to get it straight. God's waiting for you to be willing to put your clothes on and your boots on and follow when you have no bloody idea where you're going. Jesus fishing today. At this moment, Jesus, fishing right now is a stupid idea. I've been fishing all night. It's not going to work. But because you said so, I'll do it. I'll do it. You see, God had told those people in that wilderness, you're going to the promised land. Moses is going to come back with instructions. But in the meantime, between the promise and the reality, they got restless. Their expectations weren't met and they started worshiping other things. When God says, follow me, put your clothes on. Put your shoes on. Don't worry about the when. Don't worry about the how.
For our closing hymn today, we will be singing number 590, Trust and Obey. 590.
Trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but his smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Not
a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and